Well, the one dude, I used to use his desk sometimes, and I just checked his browser history one time, and it was all, like, little titty nude sites. Like, it was all, like, small tits, money shot.
Yeah, teen freak.
Is that a common thing to search for? Little titties?
That's not what I search for.
Big titties.
That's
what
that's
the
something.
Fuck, dude?
I want a small.
A not fat ass.
No ass.
Small ass. Small ass. Literally no ass.
Tiny titties.
Small titties, no ass.
I'm sorry, baby. It's what I like.
Bony bitch.
Oh, God.
Good Lord.
Oh, shit. Wow. Well, that was a good laugh.
Oh, God. Oh, God. He's lost his shit.
It came out my nose.
Are you all right?
I thought I was done.
Are you drowning? He's dying.
He probably pictured someone Googling small titties. Just going... Fuck.
The last round of last round of
horror show.
Welcome to the last round of horror show. I'm Frank. This is Jason. Once again, we have Casey Miller with us.
Yep.
And we're talking about movies. Up first, I want to talk about ghost stories from 2017 or 18, according to whatever internet thing you're looking at. Summary for this movie. Skeptical Professor Philip Goodman embarks on a trip to the terrifying... What? Hang on. Retake it. Summary. Skeptical God damn it. we might have to restart from the beginning. Oh, god damn. Skeptical Professor Philip Goodman embarks on a trip to the terrifying after finding a file with details of three unexplained cases. Written and directed by Jeremy Dyson, who worked on Tracy Ullman's show, League of Gentlemen, and Psycho Bitches. Andy Nyman, who is known as more of an actor, also wrote this. Any details you got over there?
Tagline, be careful what you believe in. Distributed by Lionsgate and on Scream Factory Blu-ray 2018.
Cast highlight for this movie, of course, is our good old friend Martin Freeman's back. He plays a character called Mike Priddle, but I think the movie would have been much better if he was cast as Professor Goodman, because he's a good man, and he does a good job.
He does a good job.
I thought this movie was beautifully shot. In fact, I had to look up who the guy was that was a cinematographer, and he was award-winning, so he's been nominated for several awards and won a few.
Deserving.
Really makes this movie look good. The story itself is kind of an anthology, I guess. The first little story is about a watchman. I don't know what this dude's guarding. I think it's an asylum, but yeah. It appears as though this building would probably be all right if it was left by itself, right? I kept waiting for this movie to be really bad, but because everybody kept saying it wasn't good. And I liked it all the way through. I had like 20 minutes left, but I'm like, is this thing going to shit on me at the end? And it didn't. I thought Martin Freeman, of course, does a good job. In fact, he does a great job at making a sequence stand out. He's kind of like the Willy Wonka of ghosts. I think this is a cool movie. I liked all the stories on their own, but I liked how they wrapped it all up in one nice little package at the end. I think it's underrated, and I gave it a 7.
The first time I watched this movie, I wasn't impressed, and I thought maybe part of the issue was is I bought this was a blind buy. Everyone's talking about how good it was. It's comes with a like certified tomato fresh sticker on the cover. So I think maybe I went in expecting a little bit too much of it. And also, I don't think I gave it, the movie as a whole, a fair chance, because I think the first story is awful. Like, it was so, it's so cliche and everything predictable. Like, I thought that was going to be the tone through the whole movie. That's really not the case. After that first story, that's a really good movie to me. A British horror anthology, and it again has it's, I'm not saying it's like a Hammer movie, yeah, but it has the atmosphere like an old British horror movie.
Right. Does. It's classy.
Yeah, it is. It's sexy even.
Woo!
Like it's dressed up.
It's smart.
It looks good. Good writing, put together well. The wraparound story is great and holds up on its own. Its own story. It, yeah. Right there with the other three cases. Felt it almost feels like a feature length, like like one entire movie, opposed to horror anthologies usually feel choppy.
Yeah,
they don't all have the same tone and stuff like this. This almost feels like it's just a feature length.
Like they took like a bunch of stories and just swirled them around in a pot together. Like,
yeah, it feels good. But I think that's the benefit of having two writers, opposed to you can have eight or more writers in an anthology. And it's also, it's by the same two guys. This is adapted from a play. And it's the same two guys that did the play, they did the movie. So if you're going to adapt to a play, I mean, is there better people to have, really?
Right.
Than,
I mean, what it's supposed to be.
Unless they just can't do it. Now, again, the first case, it's jump scares. It's loud jump scares. Like, my speakers were rumbling. Very predictable, cliche. It could have been good, I think. It was a creepy place. It was...
Right.
Like you said, it's not... Didn't necessarily need to have guards. The second case where the teenager gets into the accident, hits that
right
goat devil demon yeah thing, whatever. And it has good humor in that one.
Yeah.
And the set, the location, the being in the woods, it was good. Third case with Martin Freeman. The expecting father or whatever, they're getting ready to have a kid. That was a good story. Good cast, great atmosphere, shot really well. Not the most original overall, but it's done really well. I give it an 8.
And you?
I picked it because...
Yeah. Oh yeah, this is your pick. Yeah.
It is my pick. I had only access to Hulu, which... led this to be the best movie that I saw on Hulu at the time.
Yeah, it's a good movie. What out of 10? What would you give it?
I think I'm going to give it a 7, even less than you. Well, even though it was
what's
my.
What's your thoughts on it? Give us some thoughts.
My thought is that I picked it because I saw a lot of reviews online and in the trailer for it, it was a 10 out of 10.
And it was hyped.
It was
overhyped, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Maybe it wasn't, but it caused me to go in. It
was.
And when that first case comes around, it's like, what, really? Like, you guys are hyping, like...
I like that.
It's a girl pops up out of nowhere, and then she disappears. And then she's behind a blanket. Like, it was...
But the reviews that I read were either 10s or 2s, and I thought I'd pick it to get a fair review. Almost want to give it a 7, because... I mean, like, I get the people's comments that they left were like, I didn't see enough. They were kind of bare. Not enough happened in the story.
Yeah, that's true.
But I was watching it as the title of the movie, and like growing up, hearing ghost stories is what it felt like when I was watching. Because when you hear someone that you know, like a friend or whatever, tell a ghost story, there isn't always there isn't always a lot of resolution to it, or a lot of, you know,
detail. Yeah.
Detail or ending, it's they kind of give you the setup of what was happening at the time of day, what they saw, and that's the end. You don't always get a conclusion to it. Watching it, it felt like I was hearing ghost stories that I had heard growing up, so I think that's what it was trying to be, was a collection of ghost stories. I think they did a good job tying it all together. Maybe a bit confusing.
A little bit.
A little bit confusing at the end. Like, I get the point, but not quite exactly how they all tied in. Like, I get how they tried to tie it in, but maybe a little bit confusing. But it felt like I was listening to ghost stories, and I liked it for that, so I'll give it a 7.
What'd you give it?
I can't remember. I think it's approved, though.
Fuck, I can't remember.
I have to go back.
I don't have my notes.
He's got his notes this time around.
I don't know.
Let me see how fast it is.
Paper's a lot quicker.
7 out of 10.
7 out of 10.
So that makes it approved, right?
What is that? 7 to 7 and 8?
No.
A 7, 8, and 9.
Wait, what?
I don't know.
Who gave it a 9?
I'm just saying things.
It's not approved.
Don't watch this movie.
I gave it an 8, but don't watch it.
High Tension, 2003. Summary for this film. Best friends Marie and Alexia decide to spend a quiet weekend at Alexia's parents' secluded farmhouse.
Alex?
Yeah, that's
what she's
called
her, though.
But on the night of the arrival, the girl's idyllic getaway turns into an endless night of horror. Written by Alexandra Aja? Whatever.
Aha. Uh-huh.
However you say that. From Hills Have Eyes 2006, Mirrors, Maniac 2012, Piranha 3D, and Horns. So that's a lot of movies. Additional writing credit going to Gregory Levasseur. I think Dean Koontz probably could have used, evidently, according to the internet, he could have used a credit here too. But do you have any other details?
Tagline, Hearts Will Bleed. Distributed by Europa Corp. And on Lionsgate Blu-ray 2010.
This is one of my favorite movies from this time period. I don't think it feels like the other movies that were coming out around this time. It's not a Scream clone. It may benefit from being a French film. I don't think the storyline's exceptional because it's got that same fucking twist that, like, My Bloody Valentine has, or even fucking Shrooms. It's a similar twist. I enjoyed this movie because of how it's shot and how they navigated the twist ending. I thought it was there's a lot of really cool imagery also in this movie. The thing I remember the most about it is that scene from the beginning with the severed head. That's what stands out the most about this whole movie.
It gets your attention.
I was going to try to watch this with the original French dialogue, but Vudu does not have the option.
It's not that different. Okay. It's really not. And there's not a lot of dialogue in this movie anyway.
I always think that the twist endings in these movies are kind of unneeded, because if you just make let me know who the serial killer is or the killer and just make them fucked up enough, you don't really need that. You don't need to fucking trick me. I don't have anything against what you're trying to do. There's a lot of cool, like I said, there's a lot of cool visual stuff. I do want to find that miniseries intensity that is based on the Koontz book, just to compare and contrast, because I saw stills that looked really similar. But he didn't sue them because it's only like the first half of the book that's similar. This will always be a recommend for me. I give it a 7 out of 10.
Yeah, this is a good one. And this is probably the fourth or fifth time I've probably seen this movie. And the first couple times, I remember thinking, like, I don't really understand the story right now. But I don't care. I like it. It's done well. It's shot well. It's a cool movie. It's a home invasion. It's a home invasion slash slasher, yeah. You know, stalking. But so Combine them.
Combine them. Home invasion.
Let's just create new stuff here on the show. It's a lot of tension building scenes. Solid acting. I guess not a lot of dialogue. I watched it in French or whatever. Good characters. I like the two girls. Couple sexual scenes in this movie. This is a kind of a sexy movie too. With the severed head and the
sexy,
the masturbation,
yeah, masturbation,
the shower scene.
Yeah.
All right. What bathroom in the world on the second floor has a window right there so you can see? Shower. You're looking right up at the shower.
Deliberately designed.
Like, the window's down on the floor. But whatever.
It's very effective. In this one. That's the kind of shit a guy that would Google small titties would do.
Yes, good kills. Lots of blood. The saw thing, I think that's one of the best weapons used in a horror movie. That big circular saw thing. Good effects. The twist, I always overthought it. I was trying to figure, I thought it was some cool and elaborate twist thing going on, but it's real simple. It's basically like her telling the story how she saw it while she's, in that hospital or whatever at the end. Like, she just telling how that, I mean, she's nuts, so that's how it played out in her head. Again, I think it's shot really well. I give it an 8.
And what did you give it, sir?
Well, I'll tell you what I thought about it first.
Okay.
Here's what I think. I thought it was sad.
Yeah?
Really sad, actually. It was almost psychological. Like, I think we've all been somewhere where we're digging on someone. You're like someone, they don't feel the same way, they don't even know that you feel that way.
Most of my life.
Same, man. I mean, but to take that beyond, like, you have to be brave enough to be like, I like you even though you don't know I exist, and then take it to be like, I'm of the same gender of you, like...
Right.
Reoccurring thought throughout the whole movie was, this is just sad.
We got totally different feels from this movie.
I get why she... the emotional and mental torment that led her to feel that way. But the gore was great. Everything looked good.
There's some problem. Like,
everything looked great, but...
it just shot real well.
The gore is great. Like you said, there's not a lot of dialogue. It's all silent because that's, like, a theme of it. I guess the check and the tap... Checking the tap.
Where
he checks the tap to see if it's wet. Checks the heater to see if anyone's been there. It's very smart. Great
tension building. They do a good job.
Characters are written great. highly intelligent characters, aptly named. Very high tension. I do have problems with some things though, like the truck. Like, maybe it's metaphorical, I don't know, but did she actually, like, leave that farmhouse to go find that truck?
There's a couple holes in the each other in the cars, like...
like, she's there, but she's also the one that kidnapped him.
Yeah, the truck's going down the road, she's chasing the truck. There's some confusing things going on, but it really is...
yeah, but it doesn't
simple,
matter.
But there's some holes.
There's holes, but it doesn't matter, you get the point.
Yeah, it's good. She's telling the story.
I'm going to give it an 8. At least. If not a 9. I almost want to give it a 9, but I'm going to
give
it an 8.
Give it whatever you want.
I'm going to give it an 8.
What'd you give it?
God damn it.
I don't have my notes.
I think it's approved.
I think it is.
Throw up a steak or something. It's approved. We can watch it.
Like 7 out of 10 is what I gave it.
I definitely recommend it. I mean,
you got to give it a 9 then. It's a great movie. It's approved.
Numbers 9, mean 8, nothing.
I give it an 8. I almost want to give it a 9.
It's a 9.
Okay. Well, let's talk about the summer of 84 from 2018. Summary for this film, after suspecting that their police officer neighbor is a serial killer, a group of teenage friends spend their summer spying on him and gathering evidence. But as they get closer to discovering the truth, things get dangerous. God damn it.
Take it easy, man. It's all right.
Directed by three people with very challenging names. Check them out for yourself at imdb.com.
Yeah, they're... I mean, a Nook Whistle.
Yeah.
Joanne Carl Whistle. Mm-hmm. Francois Simard.
Yeah, you can see that, see it phonetically on IMDb. Check it out. Written by Matt Leslie and Stephen J. Smith.
That's simple.
There, yeah. Okay, well, what do you got on this?
Distributed by Gunpowder and Sky. Out on Blu-ray through them in 2018. This is, you pick this up for $10 right now on Amazon Blu-ray.
I suggest that everybody check out the trivia on the IMDb page while you're struggling to pronounce the three directors' names. There's a lot of nods and homages, as you might say, to different things, and there's no way I was going to mention all of them. The soundtrack is one that I want to own really soon. It's got a lot of really cool retro wave stuff on it. This movie is both entertaining and boring at the same time, weirdly. It's like the film equivalent of a Google image search for nostalgia of the 80s, because it makes you feel good watching
it. It is an hour and 45 minutes, so
yeah. And it's a lot of stress too. You'll be stressed out if you don't like to be stressed out by a movie. This one is not for you, because these kids are always in like a gonna get caught kind of scenario. It is a very stressful movie, but it's really, I think it's really well done. If you like that Stranger Things thing, whatever show, you might like this. It's kind of in that wheelhouse. I don't think I would have enjoyed it as much if it wasn't infused with so much nostalgia. But I give it a 7 out of 10. A lot of people will probably give this a higher rating because it seems like something that's going to be really popular. I don't know. Is it popular already?
I think it's something that'll grow as it gets older, but yeah, it's got a good reputation.
The one thing I can say is it stressed me out a lot, but I'll watch it again because now I know what happens, and I'm not worried about it. You know, I've already seen what happens. Yeah. Anyways, what do you say?
Yes, this movie is 80s nostalgia. It's got a great synth score. It kind of feels like The Burbs mixed with Stand By Me, mixed with Disturbia. It's supposed to be a isn't he the killer movie, so I guess that stressed Frank out. I don't know.
No, not that part.
I can't handle this.
The thing that stressed me out was like whenever the kids are like in his basement, you know, and then
they're gonna get caught. Yeah, well,
like, oh, they're gonna get caught. That's what.
Yeah, there's some shit that's like that.
No, you know who the killer is straight away in this movie. I like the kids in it, which goes a long way, because I feel like this whole scenario is getting overplayed now with a group of kids from the 80s. Like, it's, yep. All right, it was cool. All right, let's move on.
The thing that's funny is there's a guy that they call Eats, and it's not the fat guy. That was the...
I love that fat character, by the way. Yeah.
You look like a 30-year-old. He had some wrinkles.
He reminded me of... He had some wrinkles for a kid. The kid on...
Bad Santa?
Yeah.
That's what I was thinking.
Not him, but he reminded me of him. Yeah, I get it.
No, it does drag a bit. It's a little long. Hold on here. Everything's done well. There's really not a lot to complain about. At the same time, there's not really anything that sticks out about it. Like, there's not anything that's really that memorable. It's the same group of kids that's in it and Stranger Things. It's the same shit.
It's the Stand By Me model of movie making.
But everything's done well. I give it a 7.
I didn't know what I was getting into. I thought it was a movie from that time period. That's why I saved it for last. It was the last movie on the list I watched. I thought it was from the 80s. That was going to be an 80s summer camp slasher, so I saved it for last. It was modern when I saw it. So that
would have been way better if it was a summer camp slasher.
It freaked me out. I mean, I don't even know what to say about it. Like, the ending was good. It was sadistic, almost. Like, the killer harbored resentment for the kid that was trying to figure him out. He haunted him, you know. He didn't just kill him and leave. He
I have
like,
a little bit of a problem with how they didn't wrap it up. In one way or another, guys. Come on. Kill the motherfucking kid or no, you know?
I hated that almost. maybe I'll come back and kill you. Like, I don't know, just left him hanging. Like,
oh, you're gonna get it someday.
Maybe. I don't know if I feel like it.
Yeah, that would be horrible. I mean,
it was good suspense wise. I think it strung it along good. There weren't a lot of like kills or action in it, but it's something to watch. And
it's
maybe
like a mystery.
Maybe a 6, maybe, I'd say.
That's a respectable
At least
story.
A 6.
That's respectable.
That makes sense.
Let's get on to the... I would consider this the crown jewel of this episode, The Burning. What is that, 1980? I didn't write the year down.
Well, absolutely. The crown jewel.
Summary for this film. A former summer camp caretaker, horribly burned from a prank gone wrong, lurks around an upstate New York summer camp, bent on killing the teenagers responsible for his disfigurement. Director Tony Malam, written and created by Harvey Weinstein. Oh my god!
What?
He's the guy that started Miramax.
I know who he is. I know who Harvey Weinstein is.
You know who he is?
I saw him in the credits. I was like,
oh shit! I guess when they're.
This
Their
is his
first,
yeah. Him and his brother. But yeah, got some. The one writer on here though, Peter Lawrence, worked with Thundercats and Silverhawks. Man, he really had a lot of stuff. What do you got over there?
Yeah, tagline: Gather around the campfire to die. Distributed by Filmways Pictures. This has got a few Blu-rays. Scream Factory's got it. Arrow's got it. I had the Scream Factory from 2013.
So, what happens in this movie is this caretaker guy, Cropsy, these kids hate him for whatever fucking reason, and they decide they're going to play a prank on him. Now, the prank includes some sort of skull candle with a lot of worms on it. And
Which
I think
looks great.
It does. It looks really cool. Gotta say, though, Cropsy kind of killed himself or fucked himself up, whatever. overreacting to that. He just lost his shit. I thought it was interesting that Tom Savini turned down working on Friday the 13th Part 2 to make this movie. And I think the raft scene is probably some of his best fucking work ever. I love the way he attacks with those shears, too, because Cropsy uses like these hedge trimmers, whatever. And he just has to kind of... it's just weird angles. As I'm watching this movie, I'm like watching it through a Harvey Weinstein lens because of all the recent things. And I noticed that none of the men have normal sexual things with women. None of the women want to be involved with it at all. They're either like succumbing, like, okay, or they're like, get off of me.
Or they're spying on the women without their knowledge.
Even the characters who have who are couples and have a dynamic where the man is like forcing him on to the woman. It's fucking funny. It's so funny to see.
It's fucking funny.
It's funny to look at it through, like, he's been doing this, like, right in front of you forever. Still a good movie. It's a good movie. That's how he got the good performances, guys. The only issue I have with this movie is that they shot day for night. I don't know if you noticed that.
Yeah, I don't know if... I'll address that here in a minute.
Because when they shoot day to night, day for night, they're shooting in the daytime. They dim it down, and then they usually add some blue filter to it, so it looks like it's sort of nighttime. But it's really distinctive. The one dude wakes up to tell his friend about some shit that I just saw go down, and I'm like, what time is this? Because it was like broad daylight, and then that guy's sleeping next to a fire. This will always be one of my favorites, but it is very close to Friday the 13th, so I understand there's a lot of scuttlebutt about,
I guess. I don't have it written down. I didn't know, yes, it's the daytime shots when you expected it to be night. I didn't know if I was just assuming that all this stuff that took place was throughout the night, or if this took place... Like, if time wasn't moving as fast as what I was thinking. Like, did they just lay down beside the fire and have sex, or did they sleep there? And
I think there was a lot of times where it was supposed to be night where it was very hard to tell.
Yeah.
you know, no matter how you feel about Harvey Weinstein, this is a good movie. You got your Jason Alexander and Holly Hunter with their first real roles. I think that Holly Hunter said that this was the movie that got her SAG card. So you got Tom Savini on the effects. They're top notch. Despite the shadow he casts over this film, I think this is still a beautiful 80s horror movie. It's an 8 out of 10.
Well, yeah. You judge the movie for what it is.
Yeah.
But that Jared Collins actually introduced me to this movie. Borrowed his VHS back in the day. Summer Camp Slasher. And it doesn't really get any better than that to me. That's what I like. The cabins, cottages, lakes and forests and campfires and campfire stories. Like, that's, I love that horror movies. It's often gets, and I have 81, by the way, for this, but it might have been written in 80. But it gets the bad rap of Friday the 13th ripoff. I keep hearing that this script came first. But you know what? I don't really care. I love Friday the 13th and The Burning. And I wish they'd keep making movies like this. I don't care. Just change it up just a small bit. Give me the Summer Camp Slashers. Bring them back. In the beginning, or towards the beginning, you get that New York dirty New York slasher movie, almost like a maniac feel. Mm-hmm. And then we go to the summer camp. So you get two different kinds of slashers in one movie. Obviously the cast, seeing Jason Alexander, that stuff's cool. But like, I think there's some other people in there that I recognize, but I didn't go search them out. But just a very solid, likable cast, especially for a slasher.
The guy from Short Circuit is in this movie too. What's his name? The main dude in Short Circuit. He's also Doc Ock.
You recognize Spider-Man. Lots of faces.
Yeah,
I forget his name. I don't know his name.
Really like the music. The practical effects is good. Savini does a great job. Doesn't really pick up to the third act. But I think part of having good characters, good actors, I think that helps carry it through. There is some not so good things. Cropsy on fire. Like, yeah. I get you gotta have your protective clothing on, but don't ever shoot a dude on fire in slow motion, because you can clearly see this is not just Cropsy. And the raft scene, as great as it is, there is a couple times where he's killing someone and picks it up, and it shows, you know, an upward shot, and there's no blood on the shears and stuff, right. Stuff like that. But that's the small stuff. There's like three or four movies that kind of they alternate with being my favorite movie. This is one of them. This is one of the best slashers ever made. I give it a 10.
I hated it.
I didn't
like it at all.
What?
Oh, God. There were things about it I liked. I want to go through the things about it that I liked. The special effects, when they came, they looked good. I really liked the fact that Cropsy had a headquarters.
Had what?
A headquarters, as I'd call it. I feel like I've seen that term.
Hello, this is Cropsy headquarters.
I feel like I've seen a lot of movies where there's a killer spooking around in the woods. So people are in a tent, they come out, the killer kills him, goes back to the woods. You don't really know what he's doing out there. Maybe he's sleeping in a bush. Right. Nobody knows, but he had like a roof over his head to stay nice and to plan.
Know. It's nice to know that he had a place to go. Yeah.
So things look good. That skull in the beginning looked amazing. The skull candle that they first burned Cropsy with. I think that was the coolest looking thing in the movie. That's where it drops off for me.
See, we got a youth perspective here.
Has to be a generation gap, because
definitely no, it's not. It's not about generation, but I am aware that
something is wrong with you.
No, nothing's wrong with me.
You take one of the greatest slashers ever made, like, just
I can understand almost unanimous. The way that it, just the way
I've given this a lot of thought. no one's going to like me after I say this. No one at all.
Well, nobody's going to...
But, okay, so, like, I took it in chronological order. There's the skull candle that burns Cropsy. You see Cropsy get burned, and he runs to the creek or whatever and extinguishes himself. He's in the hospital for a while, and he gets out and he kills a prostitute, stabs her in the stomach. That all had to happen within, like, 5 minutes of the movie. I checked the time between that shit and the next kill, and it was like at the 49-minute
mark. There is a lot of
like 45 minutes of kids just talking about.
Like I said, it don't pick up to the third act, but.
But I was annoyed.
If you don't have fun with this cast, I don't know.
I did not have fun. I was annoyed.
As far as slashers go, this is by far one of the best casts out there.
Jason Alexander, fuck him. I don't care. I was annoyed with every single person in this movie.
He's off. He's never coming. This guy's never coming back on the show again.
It was 45 minutes of kids talking about titty magazines. That's and what lubricated an 80s slasher condoms. Is. I read somewhere online a review that said if you didn't fall in love with this in the 80s in junior high, you might not appreciate
it. That's maybe it's that way with a lot of movies.
Maybe it's something like that. I feel like
you
it
said
is,
it earlier though. You said you thought that Summer of 84 was going to be an 80s kind of, like this kind of movie.
Yeah, And
like, do you just not like if a movie looks or feels too 80s, you're like, ugh.
No, absolutely not. I can go further back than 80s. I'm totally fine with that. I felt like the pacing was wrong. I found myself yawning and looking at the clock after 45 minutes of the first intro thing. Like, when is something going to happen? Like, I get if you like it. If you like the titty magazine, the lubricated condom, like, backstory for 45 minutes, but yeah, I 50 minutes in, I was looking at it like, when is something going to happen? Like, it's
summer,
been a while.
Summer camp movie, I mean, fuck. You know, this is how much I like summer camp movies.
I'm not into them.
When they walk out in the morning when she goes to take a shower, and she has her towel, and she's just walking out to the showers. I took note of the fucking birds, hearing the birds chirping. And what a good feeling. This makes you feel like absolutely like you're there at a summer camp. Like, this is camp slashers.
See,
I
didn't spend much time at summer camp.
I never went to that's not about
this guy over here has spent a long time in summer camps
it's
in the
not
80s.
About, no, it's not
in
about
the
that.
Movies.
All right, but
it's the whole setting.
The thing I'm trying to make
that's
is
what I like.
The first three things happening within the 5 minutes of the movie, maybe it's almost near 49 and a half, maybe 50 minute mark.
Yeah, everything you're saying, I get, but you haven't told me yet why it's a terrible movie.
And then the first kill that you see after the 45...
You get that before even...
The first kill that you see after the 45-minute wait, as I think it's the dude who's out in the creek, and he calls his girlfriend out. They touch a little bit, and she's like, I don't want to do this. He's like, get the fuck out of my
None
face.
Of them want to do it.
Yeah, no, so she leaves, but the kill that you see after...
It's going to be real good, baby. I promise. Yeah. Real good.
After 50 minutes of waiting for the next kill, it looks like they dip the shears in, like, Karo syrup and just drag it across her throat. For that to be the first kill that I saw after 50 minutes of waiting was not impressive. But there is what they call an infamous kill.
Holy smokes.
Where they're looking for the lost kayaks or canoes or whatever. Mm-hmm. And like five or six kids get massacred. And that looked cool, man. Like they cut off the fingers and his fingers flop like little cocktail sausages. That looked cool. I think he drives his shears through somebody's
infamous.
Head. Like the special effects looked great. I still think the skull candle was the best looking thing that I saw. It probably looked better than Cropsy himself. I wasn't impressed with the way
Cropsy looked. No, they could have made Cropsy look better. Especially with Savini, I was surprised that Cropsy wasn't...
I don't know, man. I went in
a little bit more detailed. Mm-hmm. I mean, the candle for sure was better looking than Cropsy.
It had maggots and like worms
Who
and shit
Who made that
in its
candle?
Mouth. Tom Savini did it. It looked great. I want to find a replica, but I hated this movie. Like, I want to get memorabilia from this movie, even though I fucking hated it. Like,
Tom, what are you doing in there? I'm making a candle. It's great.
Look at this. This is gonna be the highlight of the movie.
Is that Cropsy? No, it's a candle.
I don't know.
It would be so funny if that was the thing he was the most proud of. If he was like, guys, check it out. And they're like, what is that, Tom?
The candle maker.
This is what they're going to light on fire. And it's going to catch Cropsy on fire. Okay, well, yeah. Well, wait, make sure it's centered in the camera. We want that. I'm working on the other shit. But
even like the prostitute being stabbed in the stomach, like I just felt underwhelmed. It looked silicone. It looked fake.
You know, maybe he's onto something. Maybe he spent too much time on the candle.
I didn't like it.
What did you give it, though, out of 10?
I'm going to give it a 4. I just did not like it.
Despite what this guy said, this is not The Burning like is an approved movie.
He's using that badge.
Again,
man.
Think
about it.
If you like slashers, you like camp slashers, this is one of the best made.
Think about it, though.
If you haven't seen The Burning yet, be sure to check it out.
I want you to picture this. I'm at a 4. If I go lower, I'm at a 3, 2, 1, and 0.
I'm disappointed.
4 grades lower, right. I could have gone. I'm about halfway up the scale. It's not terrible.
Some people don't like it. Some people won't even give it a chance because they think it's a Friday the 13th ripoff.
I went into it with a totally open mind, and man, it just bored me.
Throw a steak up there, Frank.
Make it sizzle.
It's a 4.
We'll be sure to get Jared's review on this to tag along with this video.
Anyways, now that I got my notes,
we can
touch on
what we got left.
Well, I just got the 5-word reviews from Facebook.
Oh, we're done?
Yeah.
All
right. You got the 5-word reviews from Facebook from our Valentine's Day special here.
Oh, shit.
Angela Molle for My Bloody Valentine, the original, says Harry Warden, the killer, not. group member John Wamsley for the My Bloody Valentine 2009. Please stick to Supernatural, Jensen. I agree with that. That guy's a piece of shit. For... the 5-word reviews for this episode. Angela Molle says, for The Burning, do not fuck with Cropsey. For Ghost Story, she says, movie bad, Martin Freeman good. Doug Rinaldi says, for Summer of 84, Disturbia with more dick jokes. He also says about High Tension, read Intensity by Koontz instead.
Don't know anything about that.
And John Wamsley for The Burning says, possibly the best all-time slasher.
Nope. It's a 4.
Ding, 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 ding.
We got some upcoming movies. The poll winners for this month were Nightbreed and Dead Alive, so that'll be fun.
I voted for the Beyond.
It almost came up there.
We've got the other 2 already reviewed.
Yeah.
I suggested it, and I have no idea what it is. Even though I suggested The Beyond, I'm almost rooting for Dead Alive. I don't even want to see the movie that I picked.
I'm sure we'll get to The Beyond. My picks for next month are The Mansion and Patchwork. They're both available on Netflix. Jason, you are going with Maniac from 1980 and Zombie.
Yep.
And we will have Eric Miller on next month for Wolf Creek and Redwood Massacre. Did I say next week or next month?
I think you said next week.
Next week. We got him coming in hot.
Hurry up. You got 4 days.
Watch them all. Anyways, thanks for watching, guys. Do you have anything else you want to say?
I have nothing.
Yeah. All right. We'll see you next time.
Oh, God. Oh.